We have about 10 people waiting.
I'm going to put my butterfly behind me.
Oh, that's cute. I don't have any.
Hi, Venus.
Hi, Venus.
Hi. How are you? Hi, Joel.
Hi, Rebecca.
Hi. Hi, Joel. Nice to see you, Karen.
Hi.
Joel, I was just putting the butterfly behind me. Can you see it?
Hi.
So pretty.
How's everything in Pennsylvania, Venus?
It's going good. We just opened maybe like 3 weeks ago.
Oh, good.
Yeah, so we changed our model. So we're one-on-one now until, you know, we see better days.
Oh, well, bless you for making that happen to help those families and those sweet little kids.
I miss my babies. I was so glad to see them.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to go ahead and get started, everyone. Welcome, and everybody can kind of fill in during this time. So I'm going to go over the Zoom rules. All right, so mute yourself when you are not speaking, please. We recommend speaker view for presentation. Sharing your video is optional. And although we love to see all your lovely faces, so please share your video. And then you can also type all questions and comments into the chat. We will be doing a question and answer Q&A at the end of this presentation. That's about 10 minutes, and I'll monitor it through the chat. So you can definitely type all your questions and comments for our special guest speaker, Venus David, today. Next, a quick update from Autism Tree. We have reached over 318,000 people through our social media, which is an incredible milestone for us. This consists of our Facebook, our LinkedIn, our Instagram, and now soon it will be our Twitter as well. We just revamped our Twitter. So be sure to follow us on our social media so you can stay up to date with all that we're doing. Our posts have been shared over 509 times, which is another milestone that we've hit. And we have now have 204 impact videos on our YouTube channel.
Wow.
Which is incredible. So definitely subscribe today if you haven't already. 150 of those videos are of 204 videos have been posted since March 12th. Since shelter in place took effect, our team was really responded very quickly. Luckily, we have an amazing community of volunteers, community members, families, supporters who have been sending in fun activities and DIY crafts for kids and families to do at home, just ideas for them to help cope during this time of shelter in place. We have also, as a part of that, we started a Reading with Autism Tree series, which is where our volunteers and community members read children's books and they send them to us and we post them on our YouTube. We have now posted 37 videos and reached over 31,000 people. To date, we have now provided over 85 virtual events since March and since shelter in place. And then we also have 25 events coming up between now and the end of August. So there's still a lot to get involved in. If you have any questions, you can reach out to me and I'd be happy to tune you in. And we also offer 18 of our 20 programs, more than 20 programs actually, on virtual platforms. 17 of those were virtual. We did have one program, our Bridge to the Beach program, which was in person, which happened a week or two ago, which was really fabulous. So we're so happy to be able to continue providing these services virtually during this time. So without further ado, I'll introduce Dana Hoff and hand it over to her, who will do a quick little inspiration and then introduce Dana David.
Thank you. How is everybody? So happy just to see your faces and to celebrate so many positive things happening, even in the middle of so many challenges. I know everybody's just probably in disbelief that we're still going back to being closed here in California. And I know everyone feels a lot of weight and exhaustion from that. So I just want to give everybody a extra gratitude for making time today, and also to Rebecca for really shining the light on how hard the team has been working since literally before the schools closed. I mean, the impact that we're making can't be exaggerated. I'm just really, really touched by every virtual program we've been able to offer during this time and the feedback that we're getting. It's all new ground, new territory. And I feel very blessed that it's bringing out good things during a really uncharted time in our world. And I really think that it's now's the time to, if you haven't been, I recommend counting your blessings, because we've been doing that the whole time. And it's pretty unreal how many blessings there are to count every single day. This weekend, one of our board members just raised over $6,000 for Autism Tree from her annual event, which I just gotta say is fully remarkable. I mean, she just wanted to keep it going during COVID, which meant she just did it with herself and the three original 1K runners, and they all got sponsors. And now we just got another $200 donation today. And let me tell you, we celebrate every donation every day of any amount. And that is really the truth. We haven't had to lay off our small staff, which Lisa is now on maternity leave. So everyone, please give Rebecca a lot of extra love. Because she's filling some big shoes not having our Lisa with us. But Lisa had a beautiful baby boy. We'll be putting pictures in the next e-news. His name's Calvin. He's home. He's 1 week old today. And so we're all so glad she got home from the hospital with the baby healthy. So anyway, my question I like to have been starting with is one that I thought of because of our speaker today, Venus, and the way that she touches me, particularly because it was very challenging for me, beyond words I could find, to be doing bi-coastal and be put in a state where I'd never been and didn't know anyone was very, very hard for me at a cell level, I think. So when I met Venus, I just felt so many things, but this question came out of my relationship with Venus, who's going to be speaking today. And the question is, what does it mean to love unconditionally? If you take a minute, there's no wrong answers. Just type in whatever you think about that. What do you think your own answer is to what does it mean to love unconditionally? And thank you guys I'm always trying to add more connection. This is one way so I can not just see you, but hear what you have to say, whether it's typing or you're wanting to contribute at the end with any thoughts you have. This photo on here is so beautiful from Melissa Vetti, the great belt. And it was only taken last year. So pretty. Thank you for sending that in. We love it. We're trying to make our presentation have more personal touches like that. And I see everyone starting to write them. Thank you. And when we do our follow-up right after this, we type in everyone's responses, and our open rate for people going on and reading the follow-up email about this Lunch and Learn is about 30-40%. So thank you guys for that. Everybody is connecting and then staying involved. And thank you guys. And reading about and like kind of marinating a little bit more on what each topic is each week. Will you bring up the next slide, Rebecca? Unconditional love is known as affection without any limitations or love without conditions. This term is sometimes associated with other terms such as true altruism or complete love. And I found this video that would tell you how I see unconditional love. I just think this sometimes pictures and a visual is worth 1,000 words. So this is a short video on unconditional love. Thank you.
to me. You are so beautiful. Can't you see?
Hi, I know I'm missing you on here. I'm glad you're here today. What did you type in? I read it and now I'm blank. Don't judge people. Glenn, what did you write on yours? Rebecca?
Glenn, he said, don't judge. We're not walking in their shoes.
Yeah, and I know there's other great ones too. I just saw that one pop up at the end. And I love that video because, this dog is just trying to reach out so many different ways to this darling little boy. And then finally reaches back. And I think it's just a beautiful picture of unconditional love. And I see Venus doing that when I visit her at her So Love Autistic Preschool. She is just literally meeting these children where they are, and she has unlimited love just flowing from her, and it's such a beautiful thing to watch. It's really very much like that video, watching Venus be a CEO, which she's strong power woman, but when she's interacting intermittently, being the CEO of So Love Autistic Center preschool, all autistic preschoolers, never had been to a preschool like that in California, and such a beautiful thing. I've the amount of hats that Venus wears is fully remarkable to watch, which I've had the pleasure of doing, not just myself, but with Sandy Anderson and Joel when they did the East Coast tour, and Lisa was with us. Venus, I chose this quote because it absolutely reminded me of you. You are the sum total of everything you've ever seen, heard, eaten, smelled, been told, forgot. It's all there. Everything influences each of us. And because of that, I try to make sure that my experiences are positive. I met Venus at a Brain Foundation dinner. We were sitting together at a Drexel table. We both had a friend in Dr. Vivante. You can see he's in the middle with glasses of Venus and I, and Todd and Garrett are on the other sides of us. And so Venus and I got sat next to each other at this Brain Foundation dinner. And when she started talking to me, I felt that it was like no other autism discussion I had ever had. I tried to think about it many times over and over and over since I've met Venus, and especially giving life into me. And that's a beautiful thing for someone to do. And we didn't know each other. I think that I was feeling depleted out there in Pennsylvania. And then I meet Venus, and she just, her perspective on autism was so unique that it was soulful. And that's not a word that I overuse. I do not overuse that word, soulful. I really don't feel that I have individuals in my life that I would describe as soulful. It's just, to live that way is really hard, because we have so much coming at us every day now more than ever. And yet, Venus in the middle of a storm, Lisa and I have actually called Venus before, and she has breathed life into the situation just through her strength of faith and her vision for humanity. And that's a crazy word to use, but really, I hope that Venus will share what she said to me about autism. And the examples she gave were like that quote, in terms of what families with autism experience when people have stared at you. I experienced that very much as a mother. So did Todd as a father when Garrett was young. And he would have these insane tantrums. We didn't fly for a year because of it. One of my worst things that happened was having this older woman, and she was a large woman, and at the time Garrett was small. And so it really overwhelmed me. He was tantruming at the airport, and she came over him. And so he couldn't even see me. And she was yelling at him and I knew she was trying to help him. Like, she thought she knew how to help him for some reason. And she had no clue what she was doing. And she didn't just traumatize him. She traumatized, you know, me as a mother. And it was just like, it was just unbelievable how sometimes people think they're helping you and they're not. And I think of Venus, because when we were meeting and we were sitting next to each other talking, she was telling me some examples, like, and I related. She's like, you know, a family should just be able to go to dinner and not have people staring at them. A family should be able to do, you know, she's giving these very specific examples. And, you know, it was our first time talking, and I just felt myself really connecting to her. And then, you know, when she started talking about how she views each child and how she views everything, it just meant, you know, it meant so much that I was like, Venus, can you please tell this to Garrett? Can you please tell this to Todd? Because it's sort of like when you have a dream and then somebody takes your dream and they sort of notch it up. I mean, when does that happen? It just doesn't. But yet it did for me with Venus. And I'm still, Venus, that when, if I'm having a lights out, I mean, a full-on lights out, besides our Karen Wright, who we all know is, you know, our beacon of light, and Sandy Anderson, those are my two pillars of faith and direction, not just for me, but for Autism Tree. But Venus is like, when I need to have someone just, boom, breathe life into a situation, you have done that. And I know you will continue to do that. And I'm so grateful for your friendship. I'm so grateful for your vision. I'm so grateful to be able to say that you are soulful, and I hope that you'll help people feel that in you today, and it'll be a blessing for everybody. So with huge excitement and gratitude, I love everybody to meet Venus David from Drexel Hill, Pennsylvania, where she is the most multitasking power woman I've ever seen in action at the preschool she established called So Love Autistic Preschool. It's an all autistic preschool in Pennsylvania.
Well, thank you for that warm welcome, Dana. I really appreciate it. And I'm, you know, excited to be that, being a parent of, I'm not personally a parent of a child with autism, but I feel like I'm a parent to so many because they have touched my heart over and over again. And I'm just, you know, full on appreciative. I really am. So thank you so much. I find it an honor to be able to serve this population. And they, I'm disconnected forever, you know, and I find it, I think it's my part of my life's work, you know, to serve the autism community. And I, and just to go back, so the way I got started, I was in grad school and I had this little boy. I had no experience working with children with autism. He was 15. He had, he was nonverbal. I didn't know what to do. I was totally untrained, but we spoke to each other all the time, even though we weren't verbally speaking because he couldn't, you know, reciprocate. And so he lived in a very distressed community. His grandmother was his caretaker during the day while his dad worked on the trash truck. And he had a little brother that he was responsible for babysitting, who was 7. So what I found myself doing is staying at their house, waiting for the dad to come home so they wouldn't be in the house by themselves, which you're not supposed to do. But then I realized something about him. Every person has the right to the human experience. You come to this to experience life. You made it. You know, you made it on this side of creation. So just because you have special needs doesn't mean you should be locked away in the house. Now, mind you, we would go, I would take him in very public places. He would run up to people, take their food off their plates. He would scream in public, and I didn't care. Like, I wasn't embarrassed because that was his mode of expression. And who are we to say that you can't express yourself that way if that's all you know? You know, is it really fair to try to quell that in someone if this is their only means of getting out who they are? Absolutely not. So we went everywhere. I took them all kind of places. And I can say, I love that little boy. I was 22, he was 15. And his dad told me I was the only one who ever understood his son. Fast forward, before I started So Love, I was working with a family out here in Clifton Heights, you know, in close proximity to where I am now. And it was this young mom, she wanted to work. She just simply wanted to work, and she had an autistic child, and she was unable to work. I was the lead therapist on the case, and I said, you know what, they need an autistic child care center. You know, she's only getting services 3 hours a day. She has to be available to put him on the bus and take him off within a 3-hour time span. Where can she work doing that? She would put him in, if she put him in a typical developing center, they didn't have the services, they didn't have the skill sets to assist him, so he would basically be watching TV or playing on some toy repetitively all day long. So that's when I started researching and realized that there weren't any services like this in this area. As long as I've been a therapist, I've been in this field for 20 years, and to know that there is nothing remotely close to what I believe that these families need, I figured I would just start one. And I can say that it, you know, you think when you work with this population that you're in here to change them, but they change you. It creates patience. Your heart is open to so much love because you see individuals for the best that they can be. I don't believe, I hear all kind of diagnoses from severe to mild. And what I tell every parent is no human can tell you the capacity of another human. Who can say, we believe science, we believe doctors, that is a notation on a piece of paper. But the human that is before us has vast potential if we believe those who are servicing them in that potential. And I have seen children rise to the occasion and go above and beyond because we believe that they could be their highest and best self. And that's really why we do what we do.
That's fabulous, Venus. Thank you so much.
Venus, can you scoot it where we can see more of you?
Let me lift my chair.
I just can't see you very good when you're talking. That's good. Okay. That's a little better, maybe.
Okay.
Perfect.
Oh, good. Now we can see your necklace, too. Great. Okay.
So, Venus, I have a question for you. So, you just recently opened up, right, back up from shelter in place, your preschool, and started that up. What's working right now for you and the families that you're serving? Is there anything in particular that is helping them the most that you want to share with our community that has helped them during shelter in place and then now through your center?
Well, yeah, a lot. Well, one is we stayed in communication with the families while we were on break. We were checking in, we were providing resources and tools online. I even attempted to build an online teaching platform, which is totally out of my wheelhouse. I didn't have the skills to do it, but I was like, listen, you guys need something, you know? And I knew based on dealing with the children every day that telehealth probably wasn't the best vehicle for them, being as though we service early intervention and knowing the way that they engage. They just needed to translate over to the parents what we do every day. So they were happy for us just to be back open because it was like no like and trust. We know who you are. We believe, and it's beyond like, we love these families and these families love us. And they trust us. They know that we are going to take all the precautions necessary to keep their children safe. Always had open communication with them. So we modified our model a little bit, considerably. We are a group-based model before, 1-to-3 ratio, and now we are 1-to-1 with each child in their own room with their own personalized set of toys that we rotate every 2 weeks and sanitize daily or throughout the day. We spread out the sessions. We don't provide currently, we don't have before care or after care, we don't do naps. But we do provide the same program that we were providing before, but we're just doing it one-on-one. And the families, within 2 weeks, no lie, they were like, oh my gosh, we're so glad you guys are back open. They needed this. They needed to get back to what they were used to.
That's amazing that you've been able to provide that for them. do you have any creative ideas or strategies for those parents who are still at home, who have to care for their child and keep their child engaged? And like last week, we had Dr. Vivanti talk about play strategies. And I know that you really focus on that as well. At your center. So is there anything any tips or any strategies that you want to share for parents who don't want to take the risk of going outside and want to stay at home?
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things, parents don't have to be therapists. They just need to know how to play. And meeting that child where they are. So if they're twiddling with something, I don't have any toys in front of me, but say they have a fidget and you can either pick up something like that and model what you're doing with them. You can, you know, elevate the play scheme by, you know, making exaggerated faces or exaggerated noises, just meeting them where they are and connecting. It's not always about pulling out something sophisticated to have a therapy session. There are so many skills that are embedded in natural play. If I'm doing something and we're doing, if we're blowing bubbles and I'm saying pop, 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 now there's visual tracking. There is, you know, they're localizing to sound. They could raise their, you know, what do you call it? I'm trying to think of the term. Oh, they can point to a proximal or distal point depending on where the bubble is floating. They can check back in with you to visually indicate they're ready to go on to the next task. So these things you can do indoors or outdoors, just regular games that you, even a running game out in the backyard or running around the dining room table. And more importantly, and I think this is so important during this COVID time, parents have to give themselves permission to breathe. That, and I think that's the biggest thing. I'm a parent, I have children. And if you're in the house constantly, your children are not going to the places they are used to going, there's sensory overload for all parties involved. That's the parents, that's the children. And so we have to take a break, you know, and regroup so we can be our best selves to our children. So if your child is stimming that particular day because they can't communicate, wait a minute, my schedule has changed. I'm not seeing the people I used to see. I'm not going to the places that I used to go to. They're not saying that, but they feel it. They feel it like we feel it. And we have to recognize that there's some emotional upheaval. And although they can't communicate that emotional upheaval, we have to give them space to sort of express it. I think that's important. So there may be a few more tantrums. It's okay. There may be a little bit more stimming. It's okay. And then when it's over, hey, let's regroup. And when you're finding yourself as a parent frustrated because, all right, my sensory overload is up here and this child is off the rails today, we have a responsibility to pull back, check our own emotions. I'm not in a good space right now. Let me pause. Let me not take it out on them because they're already dealing with stuff that they can't communicate. And it's unfair for them, for me to cast what I'm feeling onto them on top of what they're already feeling. So let us parents take a break. Let's step back and say, all right, when I'm not overloaded, I'll re-engage. And then we can do a fun activity. You can have an extra snack. You can have a little bit more juice. You know, like, give it, go outside of what the boundaries a little bit. They need some space because this is difficult for all of us, mm-hmm. you know, and it's particularly difficult for parents with children with special needs. So we, you know, giving, and I wrote in, I think I put a little note. Yeah, keep the routine loose but predictable as well. So, all right, if we typically go to bed at 8:30, well, guess what? No one's going anywhere tomorrow. So if it's 9 o'clock, 9:30, it's okay. If they want to watch another 30 minutes, if it's not going to create an aversive behavior in them, it's okay. And try to pick at least one novel thing to do per week. So in therapy, we always say, you know, kids respond really well to novelty. It's new, it's exciting, it's something that, you know, they haven't presented before. If you present a new toy, sit down, play with them. If you present a new activity, if you present a new book, and this is for kiddos who are a little older on the spectrum, whatever you present to them, sit down, engage. If they get it a little bit, okay. If they don't, it's okay. Just let things be. We don't have to be wound up during this time. When we give ourselves permission to breathe, we're also giving the child permission to breathe. So that's really my ultimate advice for parents.
I love that. Sandy Anderson, thank you, Sandy, for submitting this question. She said, what supports can we do to love on parents and encourage them?
Say that again.
What supports can we do to love on parents and encourage them during this?
Well, since everything is virtual now, meetups like this, exactly what you guys, the Autism Tree Project Foundation is doing, giving parents an outlet, sending them a virtual gift card, you know, to something, you know, like that delayed gratification. When you go back outside, look what you can do, you know, something like that. But having an ear, and not for advice, just so they can vent. Everyone needs that. Everyone needs to talk, get it out. I'm frustrated today, I'm upset. The job is having me do all these things. I'm not taking into consideration that I'm still a parent. I'm still nervous about being in the middle of a pandemic and sort of dealing with all those emotions, being isolated from my family. So connecting with other people, whether it's on a group chat, even if you need to see people and you park your cars in separate directions in a parking lot and just talk so you can see another human in real life besides through a screen, these are the things that I think are important. Or opportunities for parents to connect and get the support that they need, mm-hmm. without being face-to-face, of course.
Yes, I love it. Terrence, thanks for sending your question.
How do you get advice from others?
Yes. What you said?
How do you get advice from others?
I call. You mean like if I need the answer to something and, yes. You know, yeah, I ask my, hi, how are you?
Oh, I'm good, how are you?
Terrence.
I'm nice to meet you, Venus.
I'll call them or I'll text them, you know, no man's an island.
Text?
Yeah, I'll text them. Sometimes people are busy, but, you know, if I need to talk, I'll call, they'll call me back. But if I have a question, if I don't know the answer, I just reach out.
Okay.
Yeah.
I do it both, like a call and text. I do it both at the same time, like sometimes.
That's good. And when you do that, do you get the answer that you need and allow for you to move on?
Yes.
That's good. I'm glad to hear that.
Thank you.
I want to share some with you guys. If you don't know Terrence, I met Terrence.
Hi, I'm right here.
When I went to see a documentary about him. So, Rebecca, Terrence, maybe we can put in this follow-up email the documentary that was done about you. What was it called?
Terrence, you can also type it in.
Oh, sorry.
We can hear you now. Go ahead. What's the documentary called?
I'll type down a chat real quick.
Okay. It's a really nice documentary they did about Terrence. He's a musician, okay. And he's super talented.
Dad, I saw you last year in a conference on, that was November 1st, 2019.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had Terrence come and speak at the neuroscience conference as part of the Living Autistic panel. And you did a fabulous job, Terrence. Thank you for reminding me about that.
Oh, that's awesome.
So Venus, going back to, our families and your center in particular, you're doing so much for so many families on the East Coast. Do you have any plans for expanding your center or teaching or sharing the model that you've created with other people in different locations?
Yes, I get a lot of direct messages asking about what we do and how we do it. And I'm open to share because so love can't be everywhere. I do realize that, although we want to. however, I always tell people, okay, I want to sort of build out in Pennsylvania. And because of that landscape, we have 67 counties. At least 42 of those counties are very rural. And we want to provide services in those counties first and then branch out to, you know, neighboring states. So we're in the tri-state area with New Jersey, Delaware, and Pennsylvania. So we want to do some brick and mortars, not a lot of brick and mortars because it's fiscally top heavy. And then we'll go from there. Looking on the sort of being bi-coastal, I would probably just have to share what we do. I haven't looked at, like, you know, being in two regions at one time, but that's something I'm open to, a lot of things for SOLA, because I want to meet the needs of so many families. But it's still, like I always say, it's just doing it in God's timing and not in my own time. Like, you know, if there is an opportunity and I see it fits into the vision and mission of So Love, then I'll go for it. But it's nothing like capricious or anything like that. It's very strategic. Does it make sense right now? We were looking to expand and then, you know, we were quarantined. So we dialed back some of some of the things that we were pursuing just until the playing field levels out a little bit, probably in the beginning of 2021.
Wonderful. Yeah, one thing we're really grateful for at Autism Tree is through our virtual programs, we are able to have a reach and have people from the East Coast join our Lunch and Learns, like that's yourself, awesome. And like other supporters and other families who are attending our virtual programs, like our musical playgroup, who, or maybe they live in North County and it's a far drive to our office in Point Loma, and we're just happy to be able to provide that for them so they can still do something during this time.
That's good. I'm interested in the telehealth, not just telehealth. I don't want to just be therapy, but opportunities. I need a break to build it out.
Yeah. Well, we have about 3 minutes left. So if anybody wants to type another question for Venus in the chat or unmute yourself, now is the time to do it. All right. Thank you, Karen. Karen says, what is your favorite scripture, Venus?
It's my life scripture. Isaiah 10:4, I believe. He has given me the tongue of the learned so that I may speak a word in season to the souls of them who are weary.
What does that mean to you?
It means that the aggregate of all my knowledge and the things that I've learned are not for me. I'm a vessel, a conduit for these things to flow through. And if I can help someone as I travel along the way, then my living is not in vain.
That's beautiful.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what makes Venus, Venus. Because she doesn't just say it. When you're with her, you feel it. You feel that. You're just getting a little taste of how she really is.
Thank you. If there's any other questions, you can type it in the chat. We have about 1 minute left.
Glenn wanted that quote put back up.
Right. Yes. Thank you, Dana. I will put it back up. Hold on. There we go. Okay. Quote of the Day by Maya Angelou. Glenn, is there anything you want to share?
Me? Or you were talking to someone else?
Talking to Glenn.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Or if you want to share, Venus.
No, I'll let everyone. I've been talking.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Venus. It was very informative. It was inspiring. And I'm glad I was able to get to this meeting today. I had some time off from work, and you made my day. Thank you very much. It was nice seeing everybody, too.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate it. I really do.
Oh, wait, Venus. Hey, Glenn, tell Venus what your connection to autism is, because it's a Pennsylvania connection, too.
Well, I'm from the East Coast. Upstate New York is where I grew up. Spent some time in Pennsylvania. Worked in New Jersey. You know, I believe in the 6 degrees of separation, the law of attraction. We're all brought together for special reasons, I think. And, you know, I'm glad I met Dana and everybody from Autism Tree, because now there's a connection here in Pennsylvania. So, you know, it's all pretty meaningful for me. So thank you.
Glenn, where's your nephew at?
My nephew is in upstate New York, Buffalo, New York. So that's my connection with autism community. And been involved with him a lot. Whenever I get back to New York, I spend quality time with him, and And that's why I've decided, like yourself, when you first got involved with the autism community, you know, you get that one person or one thing that brings you close to the community. And that's why I feel as though I need to devote my time to the autism community. And it's so much easier being associated with the Autism Tree Project Foundation. It's just a great foundation.
That's awesome.
Thank you, Glenn. Thank you, Venus. We're just at about time. Thank you so much for your insight.
Rebecca, you got to do a photo of everybody before we leave.
Okay, sounds good. Well, okay. So thank you, Venus, for your time. We are so grateful for you to share your wisdom. And
it was a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, it's great meeting you.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll do a group picture. Everybody smile and turn on their camera. One, two, three.
I have one last thing I wanted to say. Is Danielle Levy on this call? If she's not, she's doing a book club of Rain of Gold. I just finished it. It's a big book. Wow. But she made me, you know, want to read it because she shared about this on the Lunch and Learn with Pablo Fernandez. Cindy, hi, Cindy Poland's on here. She's in Pennsylvania. Venus, do you remember meeting Cindy? Cindy was at Dr. Vez's. Yeah, she's on the call.
Oh,
she's wearing a hat. It's a small world. Cindy comes out to California and has friends in Carlsbad. And a big part of this book is takes place actually in Carlsbad. So I'm hoping more people will pick it up and do the lunch, the book club with Danielle Levy. If you don't know Danielle Levy, she's Dr. Levy's daughter. Dr. Levy helped us start Autism Tree. He's a neurosurgeon, and it's a really small world. His best friend is also a neurosurgeon in Philadelphia, and he opened up his house for Joel and Sandy Anderson and Autism Tree, and Cindy was there, and Venus was there, and it was really a sweet thing that we did. Really, the only thing we ever did as like an actual fundraiser in Philadelphia, and it was a really great night to remember. And I'm so happy you're on this call, Cindy, to see Venus again.
Cindy,
thank you.
All
thank
right.
you to everybody.
Thank you so much for coming and tuning in, and I hope you all have a wonderful and beautiful week.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Dana. I'll be talking to you. Nice meeting you, Rebecca.
Nice.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Take care.